Hello everyone, welcome back. In this video, I am going to talk in detail about sporulation. Sporulation is nothing but the formation of a spore. Generally, these spores are the dormant structures that are formed during the unfavorable conditions. First, suppose if you provide nutrients for the growth of organism, if you provide optimum temperature, if you provide optimum pH, if you provide suitable aeration for the growth of an organism, that we call it as a favorable condition. But when the bacteria experience an unfavorable condition, it is going to form a dormant structure called spore. And these spores are resistant to desiccation, heat, they are resistant to UV radiation, and they are highly resistant to antibiotics also. I'll tell you why. I'll tell you how these spores are formed. But first, let us discuss about the characteristics of a spore. Here we are talking about the formation of an endospore. And these endospores are formed during the unfavorable conditions. What you do in a laboratory, generally if you want to grow a microorganism, you are going to prepare a media, right? So once you prepare the media, you are going to inoculate the organism. What the microorganism will do? It will utilize the nutrients that are present in the media and it will carry out all the metabolic activities. So by utilizing the nutrients, it is going to derive the energy, right? So that is a favorable condition for the growth of an organism. But we are saying that if a bacteria experiences an unfavorable condition, then it leads to a formation of a spore. If you look into the bacterial growth curve, here we observe four different phases, right? That is lag, log, stationary and depth phase. Just look at the graph. We usually get a sigmoidal curve, right? This is the first phase, which is a lag phase. This is the second phase, that is the logarithmic phase. And this is the third phase, stationary phase. And this is the fourth phase, that is death or decline phase. Here what exactly happens is, once you add the microorganism into a freshly prepared nutrient broth, first the organism should adjust to that environment. It will not start the division immediately. First it should get adjusted to the environment, right? Once the bacteria gets adjusted to the environment, then it will start the division. Each bacterial cell will undergo the division, giving rise to the two daughter cells. See, for example, this is the bacteria which we have inoculated. When it undergo the division, it is giving rise to two daughter cells. Again, when these two daughter cells undergo the division, they are going to give rise to the four daughter cells. In this way, for each generation, the population is going to get doubled. So when you look into this logarithmic phase, there will be an exponential increase in the cell number, right? But when the bacteria reaches the stationary phase, what exactly happens is there will be a depletion of nutrients. For example, if you take this as a conical flask, hardly you will prepare around 1 liter of the media. Now you have inoculated the organism and the organism will undergo the division, increasing its population. See, this space is occupied by the growing bacteria, right? When this bacteria undergo the division, again they are going to give rise to a new progeny. But here all the space is occupied by the existing bacteria. There is no space for the incoming bacteria, right? That is one unfavorable condition. Moreover, here with the increase in the population, all the nutrients will get depleted. So there is no nutritional source for the incoming bacteria. Again, that is an unfavorable condition. And moreover, this existing bacteria will release certain toxins. Again, that is an unfavorable condition. Apart from this, there are other conditions like there will be a depletion of oxygen, which is again an unfavorable condition. So all these conditions make an unfavorable condition for the growth of an organism. What are they? Depletion of nutrients, depletion of oxygen, limited space, accumulation of toxic waste. All these are the unfavorable conditions which doesn't support the growth of a bacteria. So when it comes to the stationary phase, the live bacteria is equal to the dead bacteria. So the older cells will start dying because ड्यू टू द डिप्लीशन ऑफ न्यूट्रिएंट्स, सो देर इज नो एनर्जी टू कैरी आउट द मेटाबॉलिक एक्टिविटीज एंड दे आर नॉट कैपेबल ऑफ अंडरगोइंग द डिविजन, सो दैट इज द रीजन दे फाइनली एंटर इन टू द डेथ फेज. सो ड्यूरिंग दिस stationary phase or at the end of this log phase, the bacteria will form a dormant structure called spore, and this formation of spore is nothing but sporulation. If you take me as an example, if I am healthy, I can do work, right? But what happens if I don't have food? I'll become weak, right? If I am unhealthy, if I fall sick, I can't do any work, right? So similarly here, when the bacteria is provided with sufficient nutrients, they will grow well. But when these nutrients are depleted, they can't grow well, right? So that is the reason the bacteria will undergo a dormant structure called spore. Once the bacteria undergo the process of sporulation and once it forms a spore, then these spores are highly resistant to heat, desiccation, UV radiation, chemical disinfectants, extreme pH, extreme temperatures, nutrient starvation, and also to the antibiotics. And mostly, this spore formation is seen in gram-positive bacteria. And generally, that is the reason we call those microorganisms as notorious. Why? Because they are highly resistant to all these conditions. They are resistant to heat, they are resistant to desiccation, they are resistant to antibiotics also. And they can be viable for several years, like for up to 10,000 years or more. Generally, we think that by applying heat, we can easily kill the microorganism. And when we go for the autoclaving, by maintaining a temperature of 121 degrees centigrade, we can kill the organism. And if we wipe with the alcohol, we can kill the organism. But remember, these spores are highly resistant to all these conditions. Even if you go with the autoclaving, these spores can still survive. Even if you go with the boiling of water at 100 degrees centigrade also, still the spores can resist that temperature. And whenever if we want to wash a fermenter, after the completion of the batch, we have to take extra care. If that fermenter is contaminated with these spores, the entire batch should be discarded. Because even if you apply heat, even if you go with a high temperature, even if you run with a boiling water also, still these spores can survive. That is the reason we call the organisms as notorious organisms. And these endospores are mainly dispersed through wind, water, and through the gut of the animals. Bacillus and Clostridium are the best examples for the spore forming bacteria. As I told you that these spores are formed during the unfavorable conditions, if you take in case of Bacillus, generally, this organism undergo the formation of spore whenever there is a depletion of carbon or nitrogen source in the medium. We provide media for the growth of organism, right? But whenever the carbon and the nitrogen source gets depleted, that means if their availability is limited, then this organism will undergo the formation of a spore. And these endospores were first discovered by John Tyndall. Hope you have heard about Tyndallization process. We'll discuss it when we talk about the sterilization techniques. Here, John Tyndall has developed a method to kill these spores because these spores are highly resistant to heat and desiccation, right? So, Tyndallization is a process where we are going to apply a temperature for 3 consecutive days. So, thereby we can kill those spores. Tyndallization. So, it is a cost-effective method which is used especially to kill these spores. These endospores can be visualized using light microscope and electron microscope. Schaeffer-Fulton staining method is used to visualize these spores. I already made a video on spore staining technique. I'll provide you iCard. Please go through that video. When you perform spore staining technique and observe these spores under the microscope, these spores generally appear green in color, whereas the vegetative cells appear red in color. If you look into the procedure, here we are going to use malachite green as a primary dye. So these spores will take up the primary dye and they appear green in color. whereas the vegetative cells will take up the counter stain and they appear red in color. These are some of the characteristics of a spore. Now let us discuss about the types of spores and also the structure of an endospore. Coming to the types of spores, these are of two types. They are exospore and endospore, right? The name itself suggests that if these spores are produced within the bacterial cell, then we call it as an endospore. But if these spores are produced outside the cell, then we call it as exospore. Best example is Methylocyanus. So this is the bacteria which can form exospore. Whereas the bacterial strains like Bacillus, Clostridium and Sporosarcina, they can form endospore. So here the spore is produced within the bacterial cell, right? Now let us discuss about the structure of endospore. Coming to the structure of endospore, it is mainly composed of exosporium, spore coat, cortex and core. Just look into the picture. This is the mother cell, which we also call it as sporangium, right? Endospore producing cell is called as mother cell. This is the exosporium followed by spore coat, cortex and also spore core, core wall, and this is the DNA, right? Now let us discuss about each of them in detail. Coming to the exosporium, see here, this is the exosporium and it is the outer layer covering the spore coat. This is the spore coat. This thick one is the spore coat. It is covered by the outer layer called exosporium. And generally this exosporium is made up of protein. Whereas for some bacterial species, this exosporium is especially made up of polysaccharide and lipids. Coming to this spore coat, see here, this is a thick double layer covering the cortex. And this spore coat is mainly composed of hydrophobic amino acid and also cysteine. Due to the presence of these amino acids, spores are highly resistant to adverse environmental conditions. And coming to the next one, that is cortex. Look at the picture carefully. This is the cortex, okay? Inside this spore coat, there will be a cortex. And this cortex is made up of loosely arranged peptidoglycan layer. And here, the inner layer comprises of 20% of peptidoglycan layer, whereas the outer layer comprises of alanine, which is of 55%, and tetrapeptide, which is of 15%, and muramic lactam, which is of 30%. Hope you are clear. See, look at the picture. Inside this spore coat, there will be a cortex, which is made up of a loosely arranged peptidoglycan layer. So the inner layer is composed of 20% peptidoglycan, whereas the outer layer is composed of alanine, tetrapeptide and muramic lactam. So the alanine will be of 55%, tetrapeptide will be of 15% and muramic lactam will be of 30%. This outer layer, which is composed of alanine, tetrapeptide and muramic lactam, is loosely arranged. It can be easily hydrolyzed during the germination process. I'll tell you what is meant by germination. Here we are discussing about the process of sporulation. That means the formation of spore. But when the conditions are favorable, that means if we again provide nutrients, that spore can be again revert back to the original form. That means spore can be converted into a vegetative form. That is nothing but the germination. So here, the outer layer can be easily hydrolyzed during the process of germination. Coming to the core, it is also known as spore protoplast. And this core contains 10 to 25% of water. It also contains high amount of calcium and dipicolinic acid in the form of calcium dipicolinate. It is usually around 10 to 15% of dry weight. Moreover, this core also contains high amount of SASP, which stands for small acid soluble proteins. These small acid soluble proteins are synthesized during sporulation. What they actually do is they will go and bind with the DNA and they will provide stability to the DNA. For suppose, if we want to kill a microorganism by application of radiation, what we do? We expose that particular organism to UV rays, right? So during that process, there will be a formation of thymin dimers, right? But here, it doesn't occur with this spore. These proteins are going to bind with the DNA and they are going to protect the DNA. Moreover, they have some repair enzymes also. So if there is a damage in the DNA, these repair enzymes will act immediately and they are going to rectify the problem that is caused in the DNA. Thereby, they get protected themselves from the harmful effects. Coming to the actual process of sporulation, as I told you that Bacillus and the Clostridium are the best examples. Now let us discuss about the process of sporulation, especially in Bacillus. This Bacillus organism will almost take 8 hours to carry out the process of sporulation. That is nothing but the formation of spore, which is generally formed during the unfavorable conditions, right? Look at the picture carefully. When a bacterial cell experiences unfavorable condition, it will undergo the process of sporulation. In the first step, what exactly happens is the DNA, which is the genetic material that is present within the bacterial cell, will undergo the process of replication and it will extend, forming an axial filament. Whereas in the second step, there will be a formation of septum. See, observe here. This septum formation results in the separation of 4 spores from the mother cell. See, observe here, each cell will take up the chromosome. This is the 4 spore and this is the mother cell, which we also call it as sporangium. And each separated cell will take the chromosome. Coming to the third step, see, observe the picture here. This 4 spore is separated from the mother cell. And here there is DNA and here also there is a DNA. So initially the DNA undergo the replication and it will extend, forming an axial filament. So this is the axial filament. With the formation of the septum, the 4 spore will get separated from the mother cell. And moreover, here both the cells will carry the chromosome. Right? Coming to the third step, here the 4 spore, this small one is the 4 spore and the bigger one is the mother cell. This mother cell will engulf the 4 spore. Observe the picture carefully. So the third step is engulfment. This mother cell is going to engulf the 4 spore. So the 4 spore is surrounded by a secondary membrane. So this is the 4 spore, right? So after the engulfment by the mother cell, it is surrounded by a secondary membrane. And whereas here the chromosome of the mother cell will be disintegrated, right? And coming to the other step, that is after the disintegration of a mother chromosome and after the engulfment of 4 spore by the mother cell, observe the picture carefully. Here the 4 spore develops a cortex layer of peptidoglycan. See, this is the cortex that is developed. We already discussed about the structure of endospore. It will have exosporium, it will have cortex, it will have spore coat and it will have core, right? Now all those structures will be formed once the 4 spore is engulfed by the mother cell. It should form a mature spore in order to be released out from the mother cell. So in that process, the cortex will be formed, followed by the synthesis of dipicolinic acid and calcium in the form of calcium dipicolinate. And it will be incorporated into the spore coat. Again, see, observe the picture here. This is the exosporium and this is the spore coat. And this is the cortex, right? Everything will be formed in a systematic order. After the formation of a spore, now it is time to release out from the mother cell. This is the mother cell, right? And this is the spore. This is the exosporium, right? It will be released out. So the mother cell will release the spore. So this formation of spore is nothing but a sporulation. When this mother cell undergo enzymatic destruction, this spore will be released out from the mother cell. So this is the spore. So here it is released out from the mother cell by enzymatic destruction. This is all about the process of sporulation that takes place in the species of Bacillus. Now let us discuss about the spore germination.